Good morning and happy Easter. Here I am in the church all by myself. But you know what? Corona, COVID-19, can't stop Easter. So you are safely in your home and I'm safely here, but I wanted you to see what the inside of your church looks like because it's Easter. I have some important announcements and then we'll get right with it with our Easter Sunday morning service. You will see these around and about. These are good information right here. Things that you can do to stay safe during the pandemic that is before us. And I want to show you this map right here. This map has some good news. Yes, we have some people that have tested positive, but less than 10. As of Friday night, we have way less than 10. The darker the color, the more COVID is out there in those counties, and we're over here with almost a white county. So keep it up. You're doing the right things. You are staying healthy at home, avoiding crowds and gatherings. You're practicing social distancing. You know when to seek care. You're staying connected with kycovid19.kentucky.gov. Keeping your hands washed, trying not to touch your face, which is so hard to do. Apply for benefits if you need to. Prioritize your mental health. It'll drive you crazy staying in your house day after day after day. I know. I don't know what's worse, being in a house full of family or being all alone. It's just strange all the way around. But keep it up. It's working for us. Do not travel. I have a good friend that was supposed to be here from New York this week. She is in New York State working at a hospital that is covered up in COVID. So you don't want any of that down here. So keep up the good work. Do not travel. And the governor wants you to report non-compliance because we don't want to spread this any further than we have to. The worst of it for us is probably ahead. It won't be as bad as it is in urban settings, but it will probably get worse before it gets better. So keep doing what you're doing. Okay, the office is closed. My cell phone works. Call me if you need me. Everybody else does. You're probably wondering, what does a preacher do when everybody's supposed to be staying home? I answer phone calls. I do one-on-one privately what I used to do sitting at my desk. So I'm still working. And Sandy comes in and gets messages from the phone. We are trying to continue to do ministry. But it's a brave new world for all of us. Pray, pray, pray. The children of Israel were in the desert for 40 years as God was rooting their old ways out of them and preparing them to be his people. Hopefully, if we're wiser than they are, it won't take nearly that long for us to kill this disease, figure out that God is important and so is serving him, and make God a priority in our lives. We were a priority for him, so he ought to be a priority for us. One more thing. As we're worshiping today, boys and girls, I want you to pay very close attention to the backgrounds on the screen, because every time you see me, I'm going to try to change something in this room. And you can get a pencil and a piece of paper and try to write down what is different throughout the worship service. Every time you see me, a little something's going to be different. If I can keep thinking of things to change, write that down. You don't get a prize because I can't give you lollies, but it'll give you something fun to do as we worship together. All right, you're at home. I know where you want to be, but you're safe, and that's important. Join me in Easter worship.
Good morning, and happy Easter Sunday. As I say, stand on this hallowed piece of ground on Pine Hill, I'm thinking how we'd like to be in our sanctuary worshiping this morning, but as God would have it, we're standing on this outside sanctuary that Virgil Wallace created for our entire community to enjoy and worship Thank you, Virgil, for this precious spot on the hill. We love you, and you're deeply in our thoughts and prayers. And before I pray, I'd like to ask that at the end of the prayer, we recite the Lord's Prayer for each of us to remember that this is the prayer that our Father gave us, that we need to think of every word, every time we say it. Now let us bow our heads in prayer. Lord, it's Easter Sunday morning, Resurrection Day. Help us to come to you every day and ask for your forgiveness and accept your love to get rid of guilt and shame, because your mercy is new every morning. We love you. We praise you. We thank you. We need you. Each and every moment of each and every day. And now we should pray as you have taught us to pray. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would you join me in singing, Christ the Lord is risen today?
Sons of men and angels sing, Alleluia.
Welcome back. You can stand or you can stay seated. I really can't tell the difference, but will you please join me in reciting the Apostles' Creed? I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. On the third day, he rose from the grave. He ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. He will come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Church Universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. And all God's people said, Amen. You may be seated. Welcome back again. This is the part of the worship service where we typically take up an offering. We can't take up an offering. We can't even all touch the plate at the same time, but we can get creative so that our ministry continues. So I'm going to hold up a piece of paper because I don't know how to put a slide on the screen. We're going to do this the old preacher way, okay? You ready? Here we go. Here's the mailing address to our church if you need that, and also our email address if you want to give, start giving online giving. You can also stop this video right here and write anything down you're interested in so that we can keep our ministry going. The light bill still comes in, even though nobody's in here much to use it. We're cutting expenses as much as we can. We're being as frugal as possible. But the kingdom of God continues. Even when you're not here, the kingdom of God continues. Please be as generous as you can. We also need to continue to pay off this building. So we missed the first, the second Sunday feast. Give to that too as you're able, okay? All right, this is the part of the worship service where typically we have our video worship. It dawns on me that all the worship songs today are on video, But here it is. Our video worship for today is Crown Him with Many Crowns.
With many crowns, the Lamb tree for the Lord he wanted to see.
And as the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree. And he said,
Zacchaeus, you come down.
For I'm going to your house today.
You see?
For I'm going to your house today.
Come down.
I'm coming to your house today. For I'm going to your house today.
He draws the wheel and the rocket sleeve. I call my name a sycamore tree. Warrior must see.
Was a wee little man, and a wee little man was he. Climbed up in a sycamore tree to see the Lord he wanted to see.
As the Savior passed that way, he looked up in the tree.
And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down. Where I'm going to your house today. So I'm going to your house today.
And a wee little midget was he. He climbed up in a sycamore tree for the Lord he wanted to see. He said, Zacchaeus, you come down, for I'm going to your house today. For I'm going to your house today. Good job!
It's prayer time now, and I'd like to thank our prayer team, particularly Molly Oberlich, for getting prayer requests out on the internet so that we can be in prayer for each other. As good things and bad things happen, people have passed. Changes have come into people's lives. Life goes on, even though it's very different. Thank you for staying in prayer for each other. And the phone calls you make to encourage each other, even as you socially distance yourself from each other. Now it's prayer time. Would you bow your heads and join me in prayer? Our most gracious Lord, we have to confess that so often we take you for granted. You're always here with us, and so we put you on the shelf of our life and we focus on other things, knowing we can always run back to you. We don't always put you on the throne of our life, and it shows. It shows when people can't tell that we are Christians, and maybe even surprised to find out we go to church. It shows when we spend our money or our time or our energy on all the things around us, but it's been too long since we've opened our Bibles or since we've spent time in prayer with you. The Creator of the universe, and we think we're too busy for you. Well, Lord, this pandemic has awoken us to a certain extent. We see the need. We're not in control. We've always thought we were, but this has reminded us that the stores don't automatically have the things we want, and we can't automatically go to the stores. And though we say we don't like school, I suspect there are a lot of children that are looking forward to going back there. Teachers are trying to teach from a distance. Parents are trying to be surrogate teachers and work from home, or however the family is working through this crisis. And in the midst of all this madness comes Easter, as it did that first Easter, when Jesus came while Rome was dominating the region and ruling Israel. He taught under the suspicious eye of Roman guards and Pharisees that should have recognized who he was. And perhaps they did, but they didn't like him. And so a plot was put in place that he should die. The Jews wanted him dead, but they had no authority to cause it to happen. The Romans could put him to death, but they had no reason. And so Jesus' enemies stirred up those that had the power to do it. And together, they watched him nailed to a cross and laid in a tomb. Father, you were only there for a part of 3 days. And then, as you said, destroy this temple, and on the third day, I will rebuild it. The stone rolled back. The Roman guards fainted. The women were confused. The disciples didn't know what to make of it. Though you had hinted to it and told them plain, your plan is so far beyond our imagination that it caught all of them by surprise. And Lord, we're no different today than they were. We've grown up all our lives in America with churches on every street corner and Bibles everywhere and Christian music on the television and the radio, and yet for so long, we weren't all that interested in you. We had a respect from a distance, maybe, but our lives were very much like the world, and your enemy was secretly our friend. But one day, when you made yourself real to us, you came into our life and began to make a change in us, so that we would not be conformed to this world, but transformed by the renewing of our minds. And so, Lord, we don't think like we used to. We don't live like we used to. We don't talk like we used to. We don't invest our resources like we used to. It used to be all about us. We worried about what other people think. And now, Lord, increasingly, as you're helping us, as you're sanctifying our hearts and our lives, we're becoming more like you day by day. On this strange Easter, we're reminded of what you did on the first Easter in the midst of all that political and social turmoil. We ask you to do the same thing on this Easter in our life and in our nation. Turn America back to you. Rekindle a flame and cause it to be a mighty fire in the hearts of believers. May we not take you for granted anymore. May we live for you. May our hearts burn for you. Take us back, Lord Jesus. Help us to become what we thought we already were. To the glory of God, please don't leave us alone, but draw near. Draw near, strengthen, comfort, give meaning and purpose, that the army of God might stand and live the life that your blood bought on the cross of Calvary. Thank you for the plan, the awful plan that bought us back and set us free. And now, Lord, we pray the prayer together that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Special music this morning is someone very special. Call up your neighbors and friends and tell them that Bill Gaither's at Louisa United Methodist Church. He and the boys, the Gaither Vocal Band, are bringing our special music this morning on Easter Sunday morning. Hear them with gladness. Scripture for today is found in John chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, and said, "They've taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." So Peter and the other disciple started for the tomb, and both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And he bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the other linen. And finally, the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went inside, and he saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus was to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb crying. And as she wept, she bent over to look in the tomb and saw two angels in white, seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head, the other at the foot. And they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They've taken away my Lord," she said, "and I don't know where they have put him." And at this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking that he was the gardener, she said, "Sir, if you have taken him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will get him." And Jesus called her by name, saying, "Mary." She turned toward him and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said, "Do not hold on to me, for I have not yet returned to the Father. Go instead to my brothers and tell them that I'm returning to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went to the disciples with the news, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them that he had said all of these things to her. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. As I preach to you this morning, I have some pictures of some of our younger school-age children taped up around the camera. I want to be able to look into some of their beautiful eyes as I preach my Easter message today. Easter is many different things to different people. For some, it's an opportunity to buy new clothes. And I suspect some people go to church just because they want somebody to see their new clothes. I suspect that because once I was a little that way. For other people, perhaps it's an opportunity for a special family time together. In certain parts of the country, you have special foods on Easter. Did you know that? We didn't have special foods on Easter. But in certain parts of the country, they have a specially prepared lamb. And these are not Jewish people. These are Christians in certain parts of America. And so, whether or not you're particularly religious or not, there are these family traditions that grow up around Easter. Easter egg hunts. Chocolate. All kinds of traditions that are fun whether or not you're a believer. So Easter might mean some of those things to some of them. A day to hunt eggs and eat chocolate. But for some, and this is where I want us to focus today. For some people, Easter might just be their first year to hear the gospel story of the resurrection and be paying attention and get it. Okay? So I realize that listening to me today will be a lot of Christians who have walked with God for a while. You came to faith in the 40s or the 50s or the 60s or the 70s. But also listening to this service today will be people who've yet to ask Jesus into their heart. The journey hasn't exactly even started. Perhaps they don't even want to go to church. They're just to the age where the story of the death and the resurrection of Jesus is beginning to register with them. They're just now old enough to understand. And this message really is not for us older folks. It's for the person who's listening for the first time. So, my intent is not to impress or expound for those of us who are older in the faith, but to tell simply the old, old story of Jesus and his love. That's my purpose today. So, this young person on the verge of faith, perhaps like those faces that are taped to the stand before me, they might ask this question: is this story real? Is it even real? Now let's just get honest. There was a time when I didn't think it probably was. But my answer today would be, after going to church, trying to build a relationship with God, watching what he does over the course of time, yes, I believe the story of the resurrection is not only real, but critically important to our future. Yes, I believe. What about you? A second question that they might ask me might be, why did Jesus have to die this way? That's a very good question, isn't it? You see, the answer would be this: God is two things that don't necessarily fit well together. God is loving, but he's also just. That means he wants to forgive, but he also wants to do what's fair and right. We've all kind of grown up in America with the idea that good people should be rewarded and bad people ought to be punished. I mean, it's kind of in our DNA. It's definitely in our movies. But it's kind of just in our hearts. When you do what's right, you ought to be treated right. And if you make mistakes, you're guilty. We have a sense of that, that good people ought to be rewarded and bad people ought to be punished. We just kind of know that inside of ourselves. But here's the problem. Nobody is always good. Sometimes we're good, sometimes we're bad. There is bad in all of us. You want me to prove it? You take perfectly normal people, put them in a pandemic, and suddenly toilet paper wars break out in the aisles of Walmart. All kinds of strange things happen in a panic of a pandemic or other crises where moral, godly people fear causes something inside of them to come out, and we kind of almost turn into animals to the point where later on we wish we really hadn't done or said what we did or said, but it's just in there. We're not always good. There is bad in there too. It's not popular to say that anymore, but I think we all know it's true. We have bad thoughts. We do bad things. We want to argue about whether it's good or bad, but we know that sometimes we like to be bad. God didn't want to punish people who have done bad things. He wants to love, but he has a problem. Someone has to pay the price of our sins. Now, what is a sin? A sin is the willful, knowledgeable transgression of a known law of God. When God tells you don't do this and you do, that's a sin. When he tells you to do this but you won't, that's a sin. When you intentionally don't do what God told you to do and you know God wanted you to do it, that's a sin. That's not an accident. We kind of enjoy sinning. That's a part of the problem. We all have an inclination to walk on the wild side, to do things that we know we shouldn't do. And that's the problem. God wants to love us, but we're broken. We have a sin problem. And being just, God has to punish bad things, but he's wanting to love us at the same time. Someone has to pay the price for our sin. And that's where we come back to Easter. That's exactly what Easter was. Jesus was willing to pay the price for the sins that we have done through the course of time. With one terrible death, he offered forgiveness and salvation to all of the sins of the whole world. How does this work, Brother Dan, you might be saying to me? Some of you older Christians, try to answer that question. How does it work exactly? You've been listening to sermons. How does it work? Okay, you younger kids, let me answer the question. How does this work? Jesus died the death that we deserved, so that we can live the life that he deserved. He traded places with us. He died in our place so that we can live a life as if we had never sinned, because it's been forgiven. The price has been paid. And God forgets everything that we have done in the past and lets us start over. That's what Easter is all about. It's not chocolate. It's not Easter eggs. It's not bunnies. It's someone taking my place so that I could live as if I were like him. And he died as if he were guilty like me. That right there can change the world. And it has. But I'm not so bad. I would have said that back in the 70s when our hair was long and so were our big belt Levi's. Back when I was kind of your age. It looked so very different back then. But inside my heart, I was thinking things much like you're thinking. I'm not so bad. Why does the preacher keep talking about sin? And God loves everybody, right? Well, let me explain it to you this way. Even today, $10,000 will buy you a car. It won't buy you a good one. It won't buy you a car that you want to drive to school.
But $10,000, you can buy a car for $10,000. You can, but not a shiny new sports car. Now, we do good things, but not enough to deserve heaven. And you see, God doesn't want to give you a $10,000 beat-up car for eternity. God wants to offer you the finest home you will ever have had, heaven itself. God's not offering you junk. He's offering you something fine. And you do good things. We do good things with our life. But nothing deserving of the gift that God wants to give us. So Jesus took your punishment and he bore that weight and he paid that price. And you get to live in heaven someday, which is where he came from before he was born on this earth. That's what Easter is all about. Him buying us back, paying the debt so that we can be free. Well, I believe in Jesus. What should I do now? You might be saying. And if you're not saying it today, one day you probably will. Because you know what? Jesus loves you. And he's not going to let you die without him, without a good effort to try to come into your life. There'll be a day and time where you'll wrestle with God. And I hope you lose. Because if you win, you really lose. Okay, what was the question? I believe in Jesus. What should I do now? You ready for my answer? Like I'm your daddy or your granddaddy or your uncle. Let me make it really, really clear. What should you do after you give your life to Jesus? You should do anything he asks you to do. Anything? Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Trust him with the most prized thing that you have. Your life, your future, your dollar bills, your talents. When you give Jesus your life, you can trust him with everything. You can take your junk to him and he'll turn it into treasures. And you can trust him with the most valuable things that you have. You know why? Because before it was yours, he invented it. It was here before you got here. People played guitar before you. People played baseball before you. People ran home runs and did all kinds of wonderful things before you. You didn't invent this stuff. He did. You can trust him with your future because he's already been to your future and he knows what will make you happy someday. We belong to him because he paid the price for us. Now this one's going to be kind of tough. I hear you asking this question. Does that mean everybody gets to go to heaven? We'd like to think so, wouldn't we? God loves everybody, right? Right. Does everybody get to go to heaven? The Bible says no. You mean just the Methodist? No. Just the Baptist? No. Just the Roman Catholic? No. Just Americans? No. The Bible says that there's grace that's bestowed on people who've never heard the gospel story and don't know any better. God is being gracious to them who have never had the opportunity to respond. But that's not you and I. We live in America. We've heard the gospel. We know about Jesus. We have Bibles. We have Christian friends. Like any good father, I want you to think about your daddy right now. Like any good father, God expects us to clean up our room and act right. You've heard your father on earth say that many times. And in some ways, your heavenly father is saying something similar. Your heavenly father wants you to clean up your room and to act right. Well, how do I know what's right? There are so many voices you might be saying. Some people are saying this is good. Some people are saying that that's good. And we just argue about what's right and what's wrong. Yes, 2020 is a complicated time in which to live. I thought it was tough with hippies, and now the hippies are grandparents, and it's even more complicated now than it was when I was your age. So how do you know what's right? That's where Jesus comes in. Once again, He showed us the way to live. And if we step in his footsteps, he will lead us to the Father. Is that kind of deep? Of course it is. God's so much sharper than we are. Of course it's hard to understand. Oh, it's hard to get our mind around it. But just know this. If you'll be as much like Jesus as you can be, you'll be on the right road. Jesus answered in John chapter 14. Jesus answered the disciples and he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Now listen to this. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. If you want to know what God thinks, find out what Jesus thinks. If you want to know what you ought to do, find out what Jesus did. Because when you get to know Jesus, you have known God. And the journey is a wonderful, wonderful journey. Well, I'm almost through here. The last thing I would expect a young person to say to an old preacher like me after everything we've just talked about was this. I don't understand all of this. You know why I'm smiling? Because you're not supposed to be able to understand everything that God, the creator of the universe, has done. If you could understand all of this, you would be as smart as him, and he would not be worthy of your praise, and you would be creating planets out of nothing with your mere speech. Why would we think we're going to understand everything? We don't have to understand everything. We have to do what he tells us to do and trust him when we don't understand. And that's enough. What if my friends don't like it? They probably won't. But you know what? Give your friends a few years and you'll find them in church too. They might give you trouble for a little while. But one day, Jesus will come knocking on their hearts, and next thing you know, you're both in the kingdom of God. That's something God does all the time. Well, if you were to say, I don't understand all this, my answer would be something like this. Me neither, because he's smarter than both of us. So we'd better get busy getting to know him more. If I've been talking to you this morning and you're kind of at the age where you understand what Jesus did and what Easter means and why all of this is important, if you feel God starting to knock on the door of your heart, you are about to start the most exciting adventure you could possibly imagine. From this old bird to someone who's much younger, when God knocks, say yes. Amen.
The gates and doors were barred, and all the windows fastened down. I spent the night in sleeplessness and rose at every sound, half in hopeless sorrow and half in fear the day would find the soldiers breaking through to drag us all away. And just before the sunrise, I heard something at the wall. The gate began to rattle and the voice began to call. I hurried to the window and looked down into the street, expecting swords and torches and the sound of soldiers' feet. There was no one there but Mary, so I went down to let her in. John stood there beside me as she told us where she'd been. She said they've moved him in the night and none of us knows where. The stone's been rolled away, and now his body isn't there. We both ran toward the garden, then John ran on ahead. We found the stone and the empty tomb, just the way that Mary said. But the winding sheet they wrapped him in was just an empty shell. And how or where they'd taken him was more than I could tell. Well, something strange had happened there, but just what, I did not know. John believed a miracle, but I just turned to go. Circumstance and speculation couldn't lift me very high, 'cause I'd seen them crucify him, then I saw him. Back inside the house again, the guilt and anguish came. Everything I'd promised him just added to my shame. When at last it came to choices, I denied I knew his name. And even if he was alive, it wouldn't be the same. Suddenly the air was filled with strange and sweet perfume. Light that came from everywhere drove shadows from the room. Jesus stood before me with his arms held open wide, and I fell down on my knees and just clung to him and cried. He raised me to my feet, and as I looked into his eyes, love was shining out from him like sunlight from the skies. Guilt in my confusion disappeared in sweet release, and every fear I'd ever had just melted into peace.
There are so many wonderful Easter hymns that it's hard to sing all of them on Easter Sunday morning in one service. But we're getting ready to do one of them right now. As a matter of fact, Bill Gaither sang for us a few minutes ago. Now we're going to sing to him one of the great songs that he wrote. Join me in singing, Because He Lives.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future.
Thank you so much for tuning in for our Easter service. 2020, what a year it has been so far. But in spite of everything, Jesus is alive. May he come alive in your hearts. Would you receive the benediction? Our most gracious heavenly Lord, you knew we were broken. You knew we would wrestle with sin. You knew we'd need a redeemer. You knew it would have to be a spotless Lamb of God. And so you sent your Son, who willingly submitted to the plan, so that the world through him might be saved. Thank you, Lord, for proving to us with the empty tomb that we can live forever with you. Thank you, Father, for taking away our sin, giving us a heart that is warm towards you. And now, as we minister to each other and to a world that needs to see Jesus alive in us, may my brothers and sisters, the family of the church I pastor, may we be united in you, O Lord. May we be fruitful and joyful until the time we see you face to face. Amen. I'll be seeing you soon. Happy Easter.